I believe the inspector may have an interesting case for us, Holmes.
I told you, Watson, I am tormented by a migraine and I need to take my cure.
I'll take only a moment of your time, Mr. Holmes.
Go on then, Inspector. But make a stab at the essence, please.
All right. A Mr. Melvin Tuttle, a junior partner with the law firm of Sloan, Swarthmore & Cartwright, dropped dead of a heart attack yesterday. We believe it was poison.
Yes, Sloan, Swarthmore & Cartwright is one of the most prestigious law firms in London.
Pray let him continue, Watson.
You may want to know that I have spoken with the partners. Sir Sidney Sloan says he never arrives before noon. Mr. Swarthmore was at his morning appointment at Bell's Baths, and curiously enough, Mr. Cartwright began an unscheduled and indefinite leave of absence just 2 days before.
My temples are splitting, Inspector. Motive?
Another solicitor by the name of Harold Diggs was passed over for promotion 3 months ago. The position went to Mr. Tuttle. Diggs felt he was far more qualified, and so he resigned.
Ah, the jealous colleague. Certainly a motive for murder.
Is there anything else, Inspector?
I would suggest picking up a copy of the Morning Times. And if you're interested, I've got the contents of Tuttle's desk down at the yard.
Thank you, Inspector. Now, if I may work on my recovery in peace.
Hello and welcome to the Solicitor's Solicitor. Now this is the optimal playthrough and I believe I have got things mostly in order. So in this case we need to visit a total of 8 locations. And we're going to start off by visiting Inspector Lestrade to see what he actually has of Tuttle's.
Well, Holmes, here are the contents of Tuttle's desk, just like I promised. A folder containing information on textile contracts, very tedious. 2 trust files with lists of properties, stocks and bonds, one for the British Museum and one for a Richard Mainhart. And a list of various properties that they owned at one time or another. Disraeli O'Brien's name's on top.
What's this? A key from Bell's Baths.
And one gold locket, which says, to VM with love, MT.
How sweet. Is there a label on the box?
Yes. J.W. Benson Limited.
Curious. Here's a bill for a room from the Knight's Arms Hotel. From the amount of it, it appears to be a monthly rate.
So from the intro and this meeting with Lestrade, we have plenty of leads to start with. But Bell's Baths have been mentioned a second time. Firstly, that Swarthmore was there on the morning of Tuttle's death. And also that Tuttle owns a key for Bell's Baths. So for this location, we don't need to visit it directly. We can send the irregulars. So now we actually have Livingston to add to the mix, and Swarthmore and Livingston were going through Tuttle's locker. So this implies that they were looking for something specific, as Swarthmore couldn't actually, well, it's assumed that he didn't find anything. So we also found out from the introduction that Melvin Tuttle was poisoned, and there is one person we can go to for some more information about this, and that is H.R. Murray.
Professor Murray? Whitson! Helms! What are you two young sleuths working on today?
The Melvin Tuttle case, and it's Holmes and Watson, sir.
That's what I said, didn't I? Now, the yard delivered a whole pile of evidence for this one. Toffee, tea, tobacco, pipe. Sounds like my breakfast this morning. All right, now I'd prefer some fish and chips.
What did you discover, H.R.?
A toffee. C12H22 oil 93%.
Layman's terms, did you discover any poison?
The toffee and the tobacco were merely toffee and tobacco. Now the tea contained the slightest trace, but more significantly, there was a higher concentration on the lip of the cup.
What about the pipe?
The tip of the stem.
What sort of poison is it, Professor?
China berry, a paralyzing nerve poison. Just traces can stop the heart permanently. It smells faintly of lilac. But you might read up on it in my book at the London Library.
Where would one obtain such a poison, Professor?
One might strike up an acquaintance with a South Sea Aborigine.
Ah, it is not then readily available in London.
No.
Thank you, Professor, for your time.
How much time was it, gentlemen?
From this, we learnt that there were some slight traces of poison in the tea itself and on the tip of the pipe, but the main concentration was on the cup itself. So that probably implies that it was Tuttle who applied the poison to the cup, mainly by drinking it, as it must have already been on his lips in the first place. And we also learnt about the poison, which is China berry, and that it's not really available in London at this point in time. But the main thing we need to take away from this is that it smells of lilac, so it does have, well, it does leave some kind of obvious traces towards it. Even though we have lots of leads, we're going to take a look at Melvin Tuttle's residence.
My word, someone was looking for something.
And it appears that perhaps they didn't find it.
Look, Holmes, correspondence from Mrs. Cartwright, dated 22 June. Darling, I cannot believe that it is over. Please, please come to see me. I love you beyond all caring, Faye.
Heavens to mercy.
What are those other letters, Watson?
They all have the same return address. 25 Chichester Street, SW, from someone with the initial VM. They seem to be dated back as far as mid-December.
Read one, Watson, will you?
Certainly. This one's dated 10 March. Your high spirits Sunday give me great hope. I believe in you and know that you will one day overcome Father's objections. But if it should take longer than you would desire, know that I will wait for you. I will wait for you forever. Ginny! Good heavens, Holmes. I do believe young Tuttle was just a stud horse in disguise.
Well, apart from Mrs. Cartwright's affair with Tuttle, we've also learned that the place has been ransacked. And Holmes did make a comment that they didn't seem to find what they were looking for. But we also know that Tuttle's locker in Bell's Baths was raided by Swarthmore and Livingstone, so perhaps they have been here too. They are desperate to get hold of something of Tuttle's that may have belonged to Swarthmore. But we have also learnt a second time the initials VM, and the name Ginny popped up. If we go to the M's, there was only one VM in the directory, Virginia, and as Casey pointed out, Ginny is a shortened name of Virginia. So let's go and visit Virginia Monroe.
Tuttle, that popinjay!
Papa, please!
Virginia, that will be quite enough. Tuttle had the unmitigated gall to ask for my daughter's hand in marriage, and I forbade her to see him. She has had utterly no contact with him since. That, I can assure you.
That's not true!
You defied my orders? How dare you! Young lady, I have a good mind to
take Mr. Monroe, please, let your daughter speak.
Thank you, Mr. Holmes. Mel and I met almost every Sunday in St. James Park and corresponded frequently. As soon as he had attained the position my father required, we were to be married. He was made a junior partner only last week. I think this might be important to you, sir.
Thank you, Miss Monroe. Most intriguing.
And this was a book that was being held by Virginia Munro. Most likely the book that Swarthmore was looking for. And, well, it's actually gone from the screen, but it does show two names that have cropped up before, which was the British Museum and Mainhart, which were some of the folders that were in Lestrade's possession amongst the list of properties, stocks and bonds. And again, we can't actually see it in the screen itself, but it seems like Swarthmore and Livingstone, well, if this is indeed Swarthmore's book, Swarthmore was buying property and underselling to Livingstone. But unfortunately, in this optimal playthrough, we can't actually discover more about Livingstone without bumping the points up. So I can't actually use any evidence from the Let's All Play in this Let's Play. So we might have to make some assumptions. Well, I'm going to have to make some assumptions based on evidence that we do have. And one other thing that we learnt was that Virginia Munro's father objected to hers and Tuttle's relationship. And we know that Diggs is very bitter about the promotion, as he felt he deserved it more. But Tuttle seemed to have a very important reason for getting this position, as from the sounds of it, having a prestigious title meant that they could marry. We do have lots more leads, but Lestrade did hint at looking at the newspapers. Well, today's newspaper, which is June 26th, 1890. Now, this part isn't too important, but I'd just like to add here. There is a personal from VM to MT. But what we're really looking for is the second page, and this is the article about Melvin Tuttle's death. The first paragraph and also pretty much tells us what we already know, but this article does contain information about the secretaries at the firm: Mrs. Margaret Porter, Miss Alice Spring, Dr. Gerald Mason, who actually initially suspected poisoning. So we have a few more leads, but the main leads that we need to take from this one, well, there's two leads we need to take from this one, which is Mrs. Porter, who is the senior member of staff. And she was one who served him tea in the morning and collected letters that he had prepared. We will speak to her momentarily to actually hear more from her. Again, I'm only going to keep these on screen for a few seconds. Feel free to pause. And there's also Miss Brenda Walker, who has taken a day off, but we will speak to her. Unfortunately, Miss Spring isn't too important in this Let's Play. Well, the optimal play, shall I say. So, let's go and speak to Miss Porter.
I suppose everyone would say that Melvin Tuttle was immensely charming. Perfect manners, perfect dresser, perfectly eager to please. Why, every young woman he met was absolutely swept away by him. He was just perfect.
And what would you say, Mrs. Porter?
I would say he was perfectly nauseating. The man was more calculating than a mathematics table.
Why do you suppose Mr. Tuttle was raised to the executive level?
That baffles me more than life itself. But I do know that Mr. Swarthmore and Mr. Cartwright would have jointly made that decision. If anyone had asked my opinion, which of course they never do, I would have recommended promoting Mr. Diggs. He was an excellent solicitor who produced outstanding work for over 11 years.
Am I to assume that Mr. Tuttle's work wasn't up to snuff?
No, he was industrious, but thoroughly unexceptional.
How did Diggs and Mr. Tuttle get along?
Well, their relationship was quite strained. But who can blame poor Mr. Diggs being passed over for that promotion and then... No, I shouldn't gossip.
Scuttlebutt is perfectly acceptable under the circumstances, Mrs. Porter.
Well, Mr. Diggs was in love with Miss Spring, who was in love with Melvin Tuttle, who was in love with every woman. Even, I believe, Mrs. Cartwright.
Mrs. Whitney Cartwright?
Yes. He used to escort her to various society functions at the request of Mr. Cartwright. In fact, just yesterday I posted a letter to her from Mr. Tuttle.
Did you post anything else of interest?
No. Just contracts, contracts, contracts. 5 to textile firms in Germany, 1 to August Heathcliff, 4 to textile firms in Manchester. It was a most hectic day, not even counting Mr. Tuttle's dropping over.
So here we have learnt that Tuttle was... His outward appearance was a very charming man, but we've also learned that he was very calculating, which kind of fits in with more information that we've learned. As Swarthmore and Cartwright decide on the promotions, and she does believe that Diggs was a superior employee. I mean, Diggs probably believed it himself, but we all believe that we are best that we can be. But with Swarthmore and Cartwright being the people who decide who gets promoted, we've kind of already learned that Tuttle had something of Swarthmore's, which could be, well, which is very damaging to his reputation. And with Cartwright, we have learned that Tuttle and Mrs. Cartwright were having an affair. We've also learned this from the letter as well. So... if Mrs. Cartwright had any influence on Mr. Cartwright, then Tuttle probably persuaded her to recommend him quite highly, especially as they attended a lot of functions together. But we also learnt as well that the morning of Tuttle's death, he posted a lot, well, he prepared and posted a lot of letters. And we also learnt the name of August Heathcliff. We're going to speak to one more secretary, and that one is going to be Brenda Walker.
Oh, poor, poor, poor Mr. Tuttle.
Did you know I was one of the last living souls to spend time with him? Mm-hmm. Well, Mr. Tuttle, Mr. Swarthmore and I were working late on contracts, you see. Oh, that's why I took the day off. When I found out about the news, I was shocked. Shocked. Shocked!
What contract were you working on, Miss Walker?
Oh, I wouldn't know, would I? I mean, all I do is type, type, type. Never read a word of it. Oh. No, Mr. Tuttle. Or should I say poor Mr. Tuttle? Asked me to stay late to help with some last-minute revising. Well, Mr. Swarthmore chipped in and we got the job done.
Where were the contracts going?
I wouldn't know, would I? It seems a bit unusual, but Mr. Swarthmore typed the envelopes himself and handed them directly to Mr. Tuttle. The whole thing was very hush, 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 you see.
You were there alone with Mr. Swarthmore and Mr. Tuttle?
Oh, yes. Imagine me alone with those two handsome men. Of course, Mr. Swarthmore is a bit intimidating, but he is a bachelor.
Did anyone else enter while you were there?
No. And then we left at 11:15 on the dot. Well, I know because Mr. Tuttle made a joke about my returning home before midnight so I wouldn't turn into a pumpkin. He is, or should I say, was, a very charming man. Poor Mr. Tuttle.
Okay, so here we have learnt that Brenda Walker, Tuttle and Swarthmore were alone. Sourced these contracts out the night before, and it's pretty fitting that they have their secretary there to type everything up. But we also know that when Holmes reacts like that, there is something odd, and even Miss Walker mentioned herself that it was odd that Swarthmore was personally typing up the envelopes himself, and he was handing them directly to Tuttle. So we need to check out Heathcliff right now. And this case is very unique in the fact that we are using the irregulars for a second time. And this is revealed that on the morning of Tuttle's death, one of the envelopes he prepared and sent out was to August Heathcliff. And this envelope from Tuttle smelled like lilac. So this is very damning evidence. And we have enough now to take it to the judge. So yes, 8 locations and 2 from the regulars. Well, that's including 2 from the regulars. So I think we're ready.
Hear ye, hear ye. The Queen's Court stands in order. Good afternoon. I understand you've been investigating the murder of Melvin Tuttle. Truly a sordid affair. So tell me, who was the murderer? Please choose from either your notebook or the directory.
We have worked out that it is Swarthmore. He was the one handing Tuttle the envelopes.
Yes, indeed. Now tell the court how he murdered Mr. Tuttle.
And we know that the envelope smelt like lilac, so it had to be on the envelopes themselves. Well, the poison had to be on the envelopes themselves. And we already figured out that the poison on the lips of Tuttle's teacup was put there by Tuttle himself, inadvertently. And we know that the poison acts fast and it stops the heart.
Absolutely correct. Now, why did Swarthmore murder Tuttle?
And we know that Tuttle had something of Swarthmore's, which was the book of various property exchanges. We don't know about Swarthmore and Virginia Monroe. I mean, they seem to have been in love for quite some time. And at this point in time, we don't know that Mr. Cartwright know, well, in this playthrough anyway, we know of their affair, but we don't know whether Cartwright knew it himself. But we definitely know for sure that Tuttle must have been blackmailing Swarthmore, as he had the book and Swarthmore was desperately trying to find this book.
Excellent deduction. Now tell us who was Swarthmore's accomplice. And again, you may choose from your notebook or your directory.
And again, we know Livingston is the accomplice, as not only was he there at Bell's Baths looking through the locker with Swarthmore, his name also appears in the book itself. And he is the person who was being undersold these plots of land.
You are correct. Now tell the court what role Mr. Livingston played in the murder of Melvin Tuttle.
Now, in this version, we don't know anything really about Livingston. We know that he is a partner with Swarthmore. We don't know about the poison. And we have no evidence of this note writing. But so far we don't actually have any information about the poison. So this, I guess, has to be a leap of faith.
Fine job. Perhaps you should consider a teaching post at the Sherlock Holmes School of Deductive Reasoning. Thank you so much for solving the case. This court is recessed. Until next time, of course.
An extremely difficult case, and your score is absolutely perfect. I'm quite sure we could not have done any better.
Yeah, this case throws a lot of leads at you right from the start. but it's one of those things where you have to ignore a lot of them. But to get this in 8 moves, you kind of, well, we've already worked out that to get these optimal scores, you need to know exactly what you're doing beforehand, as there is a lot of different avenues to walk down. Anyway, let's go straight to this case solution.
Another migraine coming on?
No, I'm merely celebrating the end of the case of the solicitor's solicitor.
An early and tragic demise, wouldn't you agree, Holmes?
I suppose. But I found his rapid rise to be far more significant.
Whatever do you mean?
2.5 years from junior clerk to junior partner in one of the very best legal firms in London. And the man, as we discovered, was no genius. I was fascinated to understand the circumstances of his promotion.
Mrs. Cartwright?
Yes. That connection provided an interesting scenario. What began as a favor to Mr. Cartwright blossomed into an affair with his wife. Tuttle, no doubt, saw it as a golden opportunity for advancement and used his copious charms on her. Mrs. Cartwright, in turn, went to work on her husband, showering unstinting praise on Mr. Tuttle. Over a period of time, Mr. Cartwright, who thought the world of his wife, began to believe that a promotion was in order for Melvin Tuttle.
The perfect scenario for murder. Husband discovers truth, takes an unscheduled leave of absence, plans and commits the crime.
In another case, perhaps, but not in this one. You see, both Mr. Cartwright and Mr. Swarthmore were party to the decision to promote Tuttle. Well, why should Swarthmore decide in Tuttle's favor? What did Tuttle have on him?
What made you first suspect Swarthmore?
The envelopes.
The envelopes?
When we discovered that the chinaberry which poisoned Tuttle was found only in traces on the lip of the cup and the stem of the pot, and even less in the tea and the tobacco, I was particularly interested in the fact that Mr. Swarthmore personally handed the contract envelopes to Tuttle for, shall we say, final licking. The murder weapon, as it were, was mailed away to be consigned to the nearest waste basket. Unfortunately for Mr. Swarthmore, one was also posted locally. So I had the murderer and the method, but not the motive.
By the way, Holmes, wherever did Swarthmore come by something as rare as chinaberry?
That took a little imagination, and when I discovered it, it helped me to understand the motive. Cedric Livingstone supplied the poison, more than likely back from one of his sailing stints in the South Seas.
Why would he want to be a party to a murder?
Exactly. You see, the book Virginia Monroe supplied brought it all into the light. Mr. Swarthmore was using his power of attorney over certain trust funds to undersell land to Mr. Livingstone, who in turn either kept it for his own use or had Swarthmore sell back to other trusts at a handsome profit.
With, no doubt, both of them splitting the dividends.
No doubt. Tuttle evidently discovered the scheme, confronted Swarthmore, and was paid off with a promotion. Clearly, Swarthmore and Livingstone could not live with the knowledge that Tuttle had unearthed their plot. So, Swarthmore murdered him.
And just as the young cad had turned serious and finally found true love.
Yes, Watson. Love doth teach even asses to dance.
Well said. May I quote you, Holmes?
Indeed, Watson, indeed.
And there we have it. This one seemed slightly more straightforward to work out. The only issues I have is with the poison itself, as we had no way to check out Livingstone any further. He was not one of the key witnesses. So again, we had to make a bit of a leap of faith with the final, well, yeah, with the final question, as nowhere before has the origin of the poisons come up. So anyway, there we have it. So that is it. Thank you for watching. I'll see you again in the next case very soon. Take care. Bye-bye.